Remember this guy? This is Eric Casebolt. He's the officer last June that went Rambo on a bunch of black teenagers that were attending a pool party that quote unquote got out of control. All right. He did a mea culpa after everything went down and everybody saw how bad that video looked. His attorney and his fellow officers were trying to give him cover. But there was no decision at that point in time as far as any charges that were going to be filed against him. Be aware that out of all the people you're going to see handcuffed and on the ground, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, none of the kids, including the girl that you see right there, that he forces her face into the ground and kneels on her, even she was not charged because she didn't do anything. Well, there was an investigation done, and the investigation was done by the Texas state troopers, basically. They turned around and gave the information to the Collin County district attorney. Well, we know what happened at that point. The district attorney presents evidence to the grand jury, and for some magical reason, the grand jury decided not to invite Mr. Casebolt. Obviously, the McKinney Police Department was relieved, and they released a statement confirming the jury's decision. But the funny thing about it is, we don't know what charge against Casebolt the jury was considering. So apparently the investigation by the Texas State Troopers, or Texas Rangers, that's what they're officially called, was insufficient for them to figure out that this guy assaulted this girl by throwing her on the ground not once, but twice, humiliating her by forcing her face into the ground and placing his knee in the middle of her back. Now, I'm going to give you the previous video right now so that you can see exactly what the feelings were at that time. Good evening, YouTube. Most of you guys have probably seen the news reports of that pool party situation up in McKinney, Texas. Now that kind of strikes close to home for me because I live in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and McKinney is about a 35-minute ride for me on the way up to Oklahoma. So I'm not totally familiar with the area, but I do come through the area, stop in, you know, from time to time. So now, just so that you know, this situation is viewed differently by depending on whether you're on the left, right, white, black, or in between, but not always. I pulled out three clips from MSNBC, CNN, and Fox, just to let you know how different people are viewing this. So I'm going to start off with MSNBC. Now I may have to break this video up because it's definitely going to be longer than 20 minutes. This segment alone, I think, is about 13. So here we go. Let's see what MSNBC on the left has to say about this.
Good evening from New York. I'm Chris Hayes. Coming up in just a moment, my interview with a teenage girl who was detained at what has become the most infamous pool party in America. One of the officers involved in that now infamous incident, Eric Casebolt, a decade-long veteran of the McKinney, Texas Police Force, is now on paid administrative leave after cell phone video emerged of a confrontation between police and teenagers attending the pool party on Friday. video has now been viewed over 6 million times on YouTube. Now, according to the McKinney Police Department, the officers in question were responding to a call about a disturbance at the Craig Ranch North Community Pool near Dallas, involving juveniles who didn't live in the area or have permission to be there, according to the caller, and were refusing to leave. Subsequent calls reported the juveniles were, quote, actively fighting, again, according to police. We don't yet know what led to that fight or what happened in the moments before the video of the police encounter begins. McKinney police said officers encountered a large crowd that refused to comply with their commands, and while one officer handled the situation this way,
Don't take off running when the cops get here. What's up, man? Oh, thank you.
It was some guys.
Okay, guys, I appreciate it.
None of them were involved.
Okay, that's what I'm saying.
It was that guy's.
Casebolt, the officer now on paid leave, took a somewhat more aggressive approach, later tackling a 15-year-old girl to the ground and pulling his gun on a group of teens in bathing suits. The person who shot that video, 15-year-old Brandon Brooks, said in an email to NBC News the fight was already over by the time the police arrived, but they started chasing people and throwing them to the ground. Brooks, who is white, told BuzzFeed, quote, "Everyone who was getting put on the ground was black, Mexican, Arabic. The cop didn't even look at me. It was kind of like I was invisible." At a press conference today, McKinney Police Chief Greg Conley described his department's response to the video.
Our initial reaction was to place the officer on administrative leave so that we could conduct a complete and thorough investigation of the incident. Virtually, we're talking to everybody who that we can come in contact who was out there or involved in this incident.
Officer Casebolt was interviewed today by Internal Affairs. He has 5 days to respond to the administrative complaints against him before the police department takes any further action. Joining me now, two people who were there on Friday, 14-year-old Grace Stone, who was attending the pool party and was briefly detained by the police, and her father, Donnie, who arrived on the scene to find his daughter in handcuffs. All right, Grace, I want to start with you and wondered if you could just describe what the scene at the pool was like before things started to get hectic, before a confrontation began.
Well, before even the security guard started letting people in, we were just sitting at the pool, laughing, having a good time, and then some parents, I guess, got threatened that there were so many people at the pool and talked to the security guard. And when we went up to him and asked what was wrong, he said that there was too many people and we need to leave, and So
the security guard tells you to leave. There are some parents there from the community who are concerned. There's a party happening, a bunch of kids. At some point, there's a confrontation, am I right, between some of those community members who are there and some of the teenagers who are there?
Yes.
And what is the character of that? Did the adults there say anything insulting or rude? Did the kids say anything insulting or rude?
Well, the parents did say, one of the parents said a very racial comment, racial slur to a group of teenagers, and we felt the need to step in and say something. And then that broke out into a lady getting physical and violent, and then that's when the cops were called.
The lady, meaning an adult community member there, got physical and violent.
Actually, yes. Two adults.
Two adults.
To one, an 18-year-old, teenager. That's actually on video as well.
Yeah, we were just rolling a little bit of that. So Grace's dad, now you show up, and what scene do you come upon when you get there?
Well, when I got there, it was very chaotic. A lot of spectators, I'd say between 13 and 15 police were there. Ambulance, fire truck. And I see my daughter crying, very upset, in handcuffs. A parent was there trying to get her out of the handcuffs, talking to the police. Honestly, it was very very frustrating. I went to the police that were near my daughter and asked them why my daughter was in handcuffs, and they could not give me a reason. They didn't know. They did not know why. All they could tell me is that she's being detained and she's not arrested. Once I pushed further, I was getting more upset. I wanted to talk to the officer that put her in the handcuffs, or had her put her in the handcuffs, and he wouldn't come over. Well, further down, later on the day, I found out that that was the police officer that was on video, and he was in the ambulance at that time. So at that time, I was very frustrated because that particular police officer would not come over and talk to me. But we sat there for, it felt like forever, but it was really about 15, 20 minutes. They said things, they started to make, almost like they were guessing on what she did wrong. They even said that she resisted arrest and she was mouthy, which she was mouthy, but that was to the residents that was making the racial slurs. Go ahead.
Well, Grace, I just want to ask you, what do you say to those women who you say were saying racial slurs at some of the kids that you were at this party with?
It was actually it was an older man, and I just want to know his thought process while he said that. I mean, you should never be that hateful towards anyone, and especially people half your age. Like, the two women got mad because we were being disrespectful to our elders. But if they really were our elders, then why were they acting like it? They got involved in the fight and they were yelling and using profanity towards us.
Can you tell me what the man in question said that sort of precipitated this?
Well, when we were trying to get a group of teens in the pool, he said to go back to Section 8 housing where you belong and get out of my neighborhood.
Wow. Mr. Stone, what ended up, how did you end up getting Grace out of handcuffs, and what's your feeling about how the McKinney police handled this?
Well, I was very happy to get her out of handcuffs, of course, but when we got home, I was very upset with my daughter. Your first reaction is to believe what the police say to you, and that's what I did. But my daughter really stood her ground and stuck with her story. She knew that she wasn't supposed to talk that way to adults, but she felt that she had to. Still doesn't matter. I was still very upset until I started talking with other parents, finding out other details. The parent that was there when Grace was handcuffed, she really filled in a lot of the blanks, and it calmed me down a lot with how I felt towards my daughter. After that, I called the police department, the person in charge, I guess that man's boss. I expressed how I felt, and he couldn't really tell me a whole lot. He said he would get back with me. He said he had things on video and on recording. He did call me back the next day. The police vehicles were not parked facing the pool, so they didn't have anything on video except for what is going around and on YouTube. But he did have things on recording, and that really vindicated my daughter. Basically, she came up and wanted to tell the officer what happened, and the officer prematurely put her in handcuffs and really did not get the basic info to find out what happened.
So she came up to the officer in question to tell him what was happening and found herself cuffed almost immediately, is what you're saying?
Yes. Well, basically, the officer asked her if she was involved. She said yes. Once she said yes, the officer said, well, put her in handcuffs. He did not physically put her in handcuffs. He told another officer to put her in handcuffs. His boss got a hold of me the next day, and I wasn't very happy with the results of it, but there's only so far you can go in discussing something like that with the police.
That's for sure. We will see how this all plays out. Grace and Donnie Stone, huge thanks for your time.
Thank you.
All right, joining me now, political consultant Tara Dowdell. This video has been viewed 7 million times. It completely lit the internet aflame. And I want to just separate out two issues. Let's separate out the circumstances under which the police were called, all right? Let's stipulate, you know, people say there are too many kids there, that they were invading the property, that they were being rude or disruptive. Let's just, who knows, okay? Let's put that aside. Your reaction to what we see on that video?
It was disturbing to me on so many levels, and it's deeply personal for me, as it is for many Black Americans in this country. And I think anybody who just has a heart, that has to be disturbing to you.
Anyone who is a child, who has a child or who has ever been a teenager, I would say, are the categories of people that should find this disturbing.
I would say beyond that. I mean, someone said to me, they said, you know, how do you know? Let's hear both sides. You know, this is the common refrain when these things happen. And I said, I don't need to know. All I have to do is to see that video, to see that portion of the video. It doesn't matter, like you said, what preceded that. In that moment,
right,
that police officer treated that girl, he assaulted that girl, he manhandled that girl, and he kneeled on top of her for an extended period of time. A 200-pound man with a gun on top of a scantily clad girl.
Sobbing.
If you did that, pushing her face into the ground.
By the way, if you did that in a park to your own kid, you would have DCFS call on you faster than anyone would snap a finger, and they would be at your door writing you up. And good luck if there was video of that kind of treatment shown to someone keeping your kid in your household. Good luck.
If you did that in this country to a dog, there would be outrage in this country. And that's what bothers me. When this type of thing happens to Black people, you don't see the outrage. And this is actually...
Well, we are seeing it. Let's be clear.
We're seeing it, but we're also seeing people pushing back and coming to the defense of that police department and that behavior.
I've seen interviews with community members who are expressing gratitude to the police for the
and putting up signs.
Yeah, and putting up signs thanking them. I should also add, the officer in question is a trainer in that department. Okay, that is an officer who has been 10 years on the force who trains other officers about how to deal with situations they might encounter on the job.
Isn't that the ultimate irony? I mean this is ridiculous. And the fact that this guy, first of all, he did a barrel roll at one point.
Yes.
I'm fairly certain there's no manual that tells you in a situation like this you do a barrel roll. So this guy clearly has issues beyond what he, you know, the way he conducted himself in this setting. But I think my issue with this on so many levels, and one thing I am glad to see, though, it's one of the first times we're seeing acknowledgement of police brutality against Black women. Mm-hmm. Because we've heard a lot about yep. Black men, and that's legitimate, and we need to continue, but you have not heard a lot about Black women.
One more thing I will say. He unholsters his weapon and points it at two. Again, as far as we know, these are all kids. Just
yes.
Let's keep in mind, these are kids. Legally, these are children.
In the eyes of the law.
In the eyes of the law. Tara Dowdell, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Still ahead, the Iraq war architect who now says the attempt to bring democracy.
Okay, so anyway, so you saw the video, and I'm gonna have to break this up into two because that went about 13 minutes. But this is obviously a progressive show, MSNBC, Chris Hayes. All right, but a couple of things here. And again, I'm saying that it's all in the perspective of where you're coming from. Okay, number one, basically, you saw in the video the two white women fighting with the Black teen. Now, what adult is supposed to fight with a Black teen or any teen, period? You know, if you're an adult, you basically, you know better, and you're supposed to take control of the situation. So that basically, I guess, gave more stock to the white teenager and her dad as far as basically what happened. Now, the father of Grace, he basically, you know, obviously he was upset, but after he got all the information, you know, he came to a different conclusion on what was going down, and her explanation made a lot of sense. But again, you know, I wasn't there, you weren't there, so we don't know. But, you know, obviously I have my opinion about it, and I'm basically siding on the side of MSNBC on this one, because it's obvious. How does, you know, one cop, just one out of, I guess it was 15 cops there, and the only one that appeared to be out of control was a Rambo cop that was running around like a chicken with his head cut off, you know, chasing people, throwing, you know, putting people on the ground, you know, telling, first they want the kids to disperse and get out of there, and then next thing you know, he's running after them, grabbing them, bringing in the Black males back, putting them on the ground. Now, why he attacked that 14-year-old girl is beyond me and a whole lot of other people. Now apparently he had told her to disperse, and if you were able to watch the video, you saw that she was walking away. She was probably mouthing off as she was walking away, which is not a crime, and he took it upon himself to try to make an example out of her. But the way that he handled her, he basically threw her to the ground, not once, but twice. And the second time, he put both his knees in her back, held her head and face into the ground, basically, you know, it was basically ridiculous. And then when he got, you know, when two guys, two young teens tried to come to her aid, he pulls his weapon. Now, these guys came at him from the front. So you're going to see other videos on the second video I make where white woman claims that the teens were coming at him from behind. That's a bunch of crap, and you'll see that basically in the next group of videos. But I'm going to end this video here, and then I'm going to pick up and start another video with the point of view of Fox and CNN. Okay, I'm getting ready to start up the video that on the Fox interview with Megyn Kelly. Now, just so that you know, Megyn Kelly is a racist to her heart, okay? She can get out there and defend the Duggar family, where they got a goddamn pedophile boy that was preying on his sisters and a babysitter for well over a year. Then they turn around, send the kid away, you know, after he, you know, he's messed with his sisters for more than a year. He comes back in, then they turned around and waited till the statute of limitations had expired before they even went to the cops. And they went to a cop that they knew really wasn't going to do much anything. But anyway, that's another story. I'm going to start the video on Fox, and then I'll make my commentary afterwards.
Breaking tonight, angry protesters hitting the streets over what they call the latest incident of racist policing in America. But the folks in the middle of this mess say the video today seen by millions only tells part of the story. Welcome to the Kelly File, everyone. I'm Megyn Kelly. The Black Lives Matter protest group has tonight organized what they call a March for Justice in McKinney, Texas, just getting underway there. It started with a Friday evening party in McKinney that quickly went bad. Residents say a rowdy group of teens first started trespassing, then began harassing the neighbors, then the confrontation turned really ugly, with alleged racial slurs, fights, and one police officer caught on camera now being held up as the latest in a media narrative about cops out of control. Here are parts of the video.
Barrel roll. Standard police tactic.
Don't take off running when the cops get here. What's up, man? Oh, thank you.
Guys,
I appreciate it.
None of them were involved.
Yeah, and this is one of the decent cops.
It was that guy's.
Whoa, sir, get on the ground.
And there goes your road cop.
Get on the ground.
Running around like crazy, cursing at everybody. And they're leaving now. And he's still cursing at them. And there go the two guys. They never got behind him. They all came from the front to the side. And now he flings her down and throws her face into the ground. Why?
Hard to watch. Trace Gallagher live in our West Coast newsroom with the report. Trace?
Megan, the ACLU called it a textbook case of overuse of force, but the ACLU also acknowledged not knowing any facts about the party, the crowd, or the fighting, which are vital when it comes to context. So for the record, the party was a combination birthday graduation pool party. It was advertised on social media and included a DJ from Dallas. Several residents say the music was blasting and inappropriate, and that carloads of uninvited teens began arriving, jumping the fence, and arguing with security. When some neighbors confronted the organizer of the party, things got physical. Listen to a teen who was cuffed by police explain what started the original fight.
The two women got mad because we were being disrespectful to our elders, but if they really were our elders, then why were they acting like it? They got involved in the fight and they were yelling and using profanity towards us.
Can you tell me what the man in question said that sort of precipitated this?
Well, when we were trying to get a group of teens in the pool, he said to go back to Section 8 housing where you belong and get out of my neighborhood.
By most estimates, there were more than 100 teens on site. Police told us the call came in as multiple juveniles who do not live in the area actively fighting. A dozen police officers arrived on scene. It's unclear at exactly what point in the confrontation this video began rolling, but the first few minutes clearly show the officer in question, Corporal Eric Casebolt, trying to get the teens to sit down and telling a group of young women and girls several times to move on. They refused. 15-year-old
Jerry
Becton, the girl who was subdued, picks it up from there. Listen.
I'm guessing he thought we were saying rude stuff to him. He grabbed me, and he, like, twisted my arm. On the back of my back, and he shoved me in the grass, and he started pulling the back of my braids, and I was like telling him that can he get off me because my back was hurting really bad.
And as you heard, the tape also shows Officer Casebolt using profanity and pulling out his weapon. Here's how the McKinney police chief responded to questions.
Well, we did see the video. At this time, I'm not prepared to talk about anything in particular. But we want, in watching the video, we did want to conduct a full investigation into it.
But others in the neighborhood fully support the police action. Bennett Embry, who's black, said, quote, "Look, I live in this community, and this entire incident is not racial at all. A few thugs spoiled a community event by fighting, jumping over fences into a private pool, harassing and damaging property. Not everything is about race." Another neighbor who you see standing here with police now tells the Kelly File that he had to send his family away because he's getting threats. None of the other officers who responded to the party is being investigated at this point. Megan.
Trace, thank you. Well, now some locals who were there on Friday evening are speaking out, saying this video doesn't tell the whole story. As some cable news broadcasts looped it almost nonstop today.
Now, who's the big fat white guy that's in there? He's not law enforcement.
Here's just one example.
And look where her head was.
What feels like, for many young people, a pandemic of police misconduct. We have to take this seriously.
You think there's an element of racism here?
Well, if not racial profiling by policy, perhaps racial profiling by assumption. The fact of the matter is we had one white person who was there say, "I felt invisible because all of these children of color were directed to sit down, but I was not."
Earlier tonight, I spoke with Sean, a resident of Craig Ranch, who was at the pool with his wife and his two young children, including a seven-year-old, as well as another friend from the neighborhood when the chaos started. So how did you know things were out of hand? I mean, what made you call the cops?
Well, one, the music that was being played by the DJ wasn't appropriate for kids that are my son's age, and quite honestly, it wasn't appropriate for some of the teenagers that were there. And then just the attacks that some of the residents started getting, being called racist for telling the security guard that about the kids who were jumping the fence. And
so the residents were called racists for pushing back on the kids who were jumping the fence. Did you hear any of the residents use any racist terms?
I didn't hear anything like that.
Yeah, right.
What I was hearing was towards the residents of the pool saying, you guys just don't want any black people here and you're racist and white.
Well, there was an allegation that somebody like that a security guard there had said to those jumping the fence something like, go back to public housing.
No, I never heard him say anything even remotely.
See, and she lied. It wasn't the security guard that said that.
When I was taking my family back home because my sons were crying and scared.
Yeah, right.
The verbal altercation started when we were walking out and with another group, and it spiraled from there.
What was it that scared your son?
It was, I think, the things being yelled to the parents about all the teens yelling to us. Just the overall atmosphere was pretty intimidating for a 7-year-old.
The real pushback has been on this one police officer, this Corporal Eric Casebolt, who's a 10-year veteran of the force, for, in particular, taking down this 14-year-old girl, African-American girl, taking her down and putting a knee in her back in what is a shocking piece of videotape. In addition to the way he handled the other teenagers who were running around, people are saying he's a racist, explicitly saying he's a racist, others saying he used excessive force, he was too aggressive, and he mishandled the situation. What say you?
I would disagree. He was the first officer to arrive there, and I mean, it was chaos when he arrived there, and I think he kind of had to match that situation with a good amount of aggression to kind of calm the crowd down.
Yeah, he really calmed the crowd down.
I was within feet of him when he sat down 13 to 15 kids and made them sit down on the ground, and the only people he were going after were people who just got up and started running. And
which is not against the law.
Kids, there was a white female was one of the first ones I saw in handcuffs. So I thought he acted the way he needed to help end the chaos that was happening.
Well, let me ask you about that, because one of the allegations is he only went after the black kids. Was it just the one white person who you saw him place in cuffs, or did you see him go after anybody else who was white?
I always saw him going after people who were running. He was always chasing people who got up and ran away from him.
Did you see any white people running away? Did he chase any whites other than, or was it all blacks?
I didn't see any white people running away. The majority of people I saw get up and run were black.
Mm-hmm. What about the 14-year-old girl? Because, you know, you see that tape and it is brutal to watch. How can you, you know, justify? Because people will be at home saying, how's he defending that?
Well, I think, you know, the officer gave her a chance to leave.
Which she was doing.
Told her to leave, and she refused. And one of the things I don't think is also being talked about is the officer ran out of handcuffs. And I think if he would have had handcuffs on him, he would have been able to cuff this girl, and it wouldn't have gone as far. But, you know, he was kind of sitting on her back waiting for other officers to bring cuffs over.
I realize this is a 7-minute videotape. How long did the incident last?
It had at least started 45 minutes before that 7-minute video was taken, and it probably lasted a good, you know, 15, 20 minutes after as well.
Describe the scene that officer walked into, because, you know, we see it, and kids are running, and he starts running, and he seems pretty amped up.
He was, and, you know, I think it's just because of the situation he walked into. I mean, there was just people everywhere. People were screaming, and, you know, there was little kids running away from the pool crying. So, I mean, he walked into a pretty...
Yeah, notice that big, fat white guy that got his crotch over the girl's head.
Other than the one that we saw between him and the 14-year-old girl.
There was a fight... between a young black girl and two middle-aged white females.
The only fight.
Security officers? Were they security guards? The women? The older women?
They were not. One of them I know was a resident. The other one I believe was visiting a resident there.
Mm-hmm. And was that before or after the police arrived?
This was before the police arrived.
Okay. Was it one of the reasons?
I was actually on the phone with the police when the fight happened, and I was telling them, hey, you guys got to get somebody here because their fights are breaking out now.
What do you make, what is the status in the area now? Because we've spoken with some residents who say they're scared. Anybody who defends the cops, one guy says he's had death threats and has had armed security posted outside of his house. What has your experience been?
At this point, is the whole neighborhood is pretty uneasy. I mean, there's a protest that's happening tonight, and based on what we've seen nationally, a lot of the neighbors are kind of concerned about how it may end. And, you know, I think the majority of us, even as a whole community in Craig Ranch, have been labeled a certain way, and that's not sitting well with anybody. Most of the people I've talked to support what the police did, and most people don't think this is a race issue. This is a out-of-control kids issue.
Mm-hmm. And what about you, Sean? I know you didn't want to give your last name. Are you scared? I mean, are you concerned for your own safety?
I'm concerned for my family's safety. Like I said, we've been getting a lot of calls, a lot of people wanting to talk to us, and you know, based on what we've seen about some of the Facebook and people on Twitter, some of the stuff being said about people siding with the police, I think we have good reason to be a bit concerned.
Mm. Thank you for sharing your story with us. We appreciate it, Sean.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
See, now, there were only a couple of lies in that whole segment, but it always depends on the way that you slant it. Now, this guy obviously, is slanting it in favor of the police. He's probably a big police supporter, okay? But he indicated that he was on the phone calling about fights. Fights is plural. There was only one fight, and that was between the two white women and the black chick. Now, there was another altercation, which was when the white girl that was on the video earlier got slapped by one of the other white women, but that wasn't a fight, as far as I'm concerned, and most people. She got slapped, and then, it broke out between the two white women and the black girl. Okay. Now, he was scared. I guess he was scared because he saw a whole bunch of black people and he didn't, and he was uncomfortable with them. Now, the music's the music, and I've got to be honest with you. Some of the music that they play, I ain't going for it either. So I really don't have that big of a deal as far as being upset about, some of the music that's played. But if you don't like the music, you get up and you leave, and that's basically it. But as far as he was concerned, that Rambo cop's behavior was totally acceptable. And if that was his kid, he would have been jumping up and down and going crazy, But again, it's the perspective of, where you're coming from. But he's one of the guys that's siding with most, not all, of the white people that want to support the police. And again, I'm going to be honest with you. I didn't really see much of anything as far as the police were concerned other than that one white cop. And as a matter of fact, the other two cops that came to him when he drew his weapon, I'm really want to take my hat off to them because I honestly believe that something bad would have happened if they hadn't ran up on that cop at the point that he had pulled his gun. My only issue was I wish there would have been a third cop there that could have at least stayed with him and tried to get him a bit more under control, or his supervisor, had gotten on the scene and took charge, because that might have calmed him down as well. But anyway, that's the Fox segment of this. I'm going to end this now, and then I'm going to show you the Fair and Balanced segment, which was done by CNN. So there you have it. Normally, a regular citizen gets a quick indictment, charges filed, etc., etc. But when you're a police officer, you get a lengthy, and I do mean lengthy, investigation in order to let the things tamp down, to let things fall away from memory. So again, when you finally come up to a decision point, a DA is able to basically just let you go, which is what occurred in Mr. Eric Casebolt's quote-unquote case.